Hi, I am Dr. Prasad Podilam, back with a new topic, Advanced Organic Chemistry, class number one, in which explaining about aliphatic electrophilic substitution reactions, in which especially SC1 reaction. So aliphatic electrophilic substitution reactions. So what are aliphatic molecules? So aliphatic and aromatic. So you know about aromatic, as I explained in my previous videos, those are having benzene or similar type of molecules which show the aromaticity. They call as aromatic compounds. And aliphatic, it is a stretch chain hydrocarbons without aromatic nature. So in electrophilic substitution, a substitution reaction in which the one atom or group of atom is substituted or replaced with other atom or group of atom, we call it a substitution reaction. If it is an electrophile, if the substituent, the one which is going to substitute, if it is an electrophile, electrophile is the one which is having, which is electron deficient, or which is seeking electrons, or which is having positive charge in the molecule or atom or atomic structure. It may be an atom with a positive charge, maybe a molecule with a positive charge, or which is deficient of electron. Even if there is no positive charge also, it may be deficient of electron. It needs electron to get stability. We call them as electrophile. Therefore, an electrophile substitutes an atom or group of atom, we call it as electrophilic substitution. Therefore, the leaving group departs, the atom or molecule, group of atoms, which we call as a molecule. That molecule, which is a, if it is a leaving group, it takes a bonding pair of electrons. Two electrons which is formed in the bonding, those two electrons are taken away from by the leaving group, and it is being replaced. That means I have to say the molecule which is going leaving, it is not taking the bonding pair of electrons. That means the bond pair of electrons will remain on the substrate itself, so that the electrophile which is the electron seeking, will go and attack on that. Say example given with carbon connected to four tetravalency of carbon satisfied with A, atom B, atom D, and atom L. So here L represents the leaving group or leaving atom, that is should be replaced with some other atom, which is an electrophile. Okay, so here to represent, to show the leaving group, I represent the CL bond, the single line, that line here, it represents the bond. Usually we draw this line to represent the bond. Actually it is two electrons are getting shared. The carbon and that leaving group L, it shares two electrons. So here I say that the leaving group departs without its bonding pair of electrons. So those two electrons, these two electrons which is represented here, they are the bonding pair of electrons. And the leaving group which goes without taking those electrons, that electrons remaining back with that of carbon atom, for the atom from which the leaving group is gone away. And the L, it gets a positive charge because it loses electron, therefore it gets a positive charge. Now here it is an electron rich center, carbon valency is not satisfied also, tetravalency is not satisfied, means there are two electrons which are active. That means it can connect it to another atom without electrons. That means an electrophile, E plus, it can simply attack, or it can go and react with the lone pair of electrons. Therefore, this electrophile attack goes near to that. Actually, the electron movement which is shown here, that is the reverse case. The electron should go near the electrophile. Electrophile is coming near the, when it comes near the carbon atom with lone pair of electron, these two lone pair of electron, these two electrons, one electron gives to the E plus, the positive charge neutralizer, then it forms a bond with the carbon atom. Therefore, it becomes a CE bond. So this is the simple schematic representation of a electrophilic substitution reaction. Now there are four different types as till now, based on the reaction mechanisms, four types are derived, or four types are identified. Theoretically, we have four electrophilic substitution reactions. The first one, that is a substitution electrophilic unimolecular, or SC1, substitution electrophilic bimolecular, in which the electrophile attacks from the front side. That means the leaving group, from which side the leaving group is going away, the same side the electrophile is also coming. Then it is known as SC2 front. It may be SC2 back also, or it may be SCI, that is internal arrangement. So we'll discuss one by one, each and every one in this particular class series. So first one, that is SC1. So this particular video class, it is only for SC1. SC1 itself, it needs too much time to explain in detail. So SC1, we can expand it. SE1 as such. S stands for substitution, E stands for electrophilic, and 1 stands for unimolecular. 1 means uni, 1, single. So it is substitution, electrophilic, unimolecular reaction. Or you can reversely, we can call it as, we start with 1, then E, then S, then it becomes unimolecular electrophilic substitution reaction. So these two terms are used for SE1, that is substitution electrophilic unimolecular or unimolecular electrophilic substitution reactions. So the reaction mechanism in SE1. So mechanism that you already studied in your previous classes, what is the mechanism in organic chemistry? It is the formation, breaking of some bond, atomic bonds, and forming a new bonds, finally getting the product from the substrate and reagent combined. How the product is formed based on the theoretically known the electron movement or electronic effect. So all the electronic effects I explained in my previous class videos, like inductive effect, resonance effect, mesomeric effect, then hyperconjugation. So all those theoretical knowledges will consider to write a mechanism for a reaction, possible arrangement of atoms, possible movement of atoms, possible movement of electrons in the atoms or group of atoms, that is molecules, to form the final product. So if you can have an idea about the mechanism, so that we can start synthesizing new product, new compounds we can prepare, if you have an idea that this particular mechanism is possible, so we can try it out. So here in case of SE1, the proposed reaction mechanism is two step. Step one, that is formation of carbon ion, that is carbon with a negative charge on that, say Rx. So here the R represents the alkyl group, X represents an atom. Okay, it may be, usually we consider it as hydrogen. Usually hydrogen is getting replaced by other atom. So here X is not symbolizing the halogen atom, just an atom, R and an X atom. So when it undergoes a slow ionization, that means that the X goes out without the lone pair of electron. So that R gets both the electrons, it becomes R minus, and X becomes positively charged. This is the slow step. Therefore, this will be the rate determining step. So rate of the reaction can be calculated by using the rate determining step or the slow step of the reaction. So in this slow step, we can see that only that one particular substrate is present. There is no electrophile still attacked. The electrophile is not there in the screen. That means this particular reaction mechanism in which only single molecule is considered, therefore it is unimolecular. Therefore, that's why the name substitution electrophilic unimolecular. Now in step two, the attack of electrophile to the R minus. So R minus combines with the electrophile. The electrons of the R or the carbon ion, then a negative charge, the electrons will go and combine with the electrophile, is a fast reaction to get a RE. So this is a general representation of a mechanism of a SE1. It looks similar to that of a substitution nucleophilic unimolecular. So substitution nucleophilic unimolecular, as I explained in my previous class videos. You can go and refer it. It is there in my YouTube channel, My Intuition. In that playlist, you can see the nucleophilic substitution unimolecular and nucleophilic substitution bimolecular reactions. Okay, so those who are not subscribed my YouTube channel, you can please do subscribe my YouTube channel so that you can always watch my videos. All the chemistry related videos I'm uploading to my YouTube channel, so that it will be useful for you. Anytime you can revisit and clarify your doubts, so you can rewind it. Any doubts, you can put as a comment to the video, or you can mail to me. My email ID is also available in the YouTube channel. And if you want to repeatedly watch this video, you please like this video. In any video of mine, if you want to repeat again, you just put the like button, so that it will be there in your YouTube channel. If you go, you can see the liked videos, so that it is easy for you to find out, even if you lost the link of this video. So always subscribe the YouTube to this channel and press the like button, so that any time you can revisit and rewatch it. Okay, during exam time or competitive exam time, if you want to watch the videos, you can take it out. Okay. Okay, so that about the substitution electrophilic unimolecular reaction. Now the evidences which supports this SE1 reactions, the evidences are that it follows a first order kinetics. Second, that isotope effect is observed in base catalyzed tautomerism. So what is tautomerism? That I'll explain coming in this video only. I'll be covering isotope effect already covered in previous video. You can revisit it. Anyhow, I'll coming the tautomerism, I will be explaining that isotope effect also. So carbon ions which are not stabilized by resonance are probably not planar. That means here we are having a carbon ion in place of a carbocation, which is there in SN1 reaction, substitution nucleophilic unimolecular reaction, in which the intermediate form is carbocation, and stability of carbocation decides the speed of that reaction, nucleophilic substitution reaction. In electrophilic substitution reaction, it is carbon ion, carbon with a negative charge, and it cannot, if it cannot be stabilized by resonance, then it will not be planar in shape. If it is non-planar, if it is non-planar, then also it favors SE1 mechanism. Say example, a bridgehead carbon. So this point will be clear if I take the example of a bridgehead carbon. So let me draw the bridgehead, CH2, 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 CH2. It forms a cyclic structure now. Now this is the bridgehead carbon with 2CH, that is CH2. So here CH2, that is the bridgehead. So those who are watching my videos, please note it down, take a book and a pen, and as soon as I draw this organic reaction mechanism, keep on pointing out, because one slide to the next slide, sometimes the slide when it changes, you may get confused. Anyhow, I given maximum animation, possible animation to make you understand the movement of electron. But as soon as it comes to your screen, you just note it down so that it is easy for you to understand the concept. So here, this is the bridgehead carbon. So here, if it loses the SE1 reactions, even it is possible for the bridgehead carbon, whereas in nucleophilic reactions are not possible with this particular carbon. So here, nucleophilic substitution reaction is not possible, because when nucleophilic substitution reaction, it becomes a carbocation, and this bridgehead carbocation cannot be stabilized easily. Therefore, nucleophilic substitution reaction becomes very difficult. Whereas if it becomes a carbon ion, a negatively charged ion, then it can continue for electrophilic substitution. So it is represented, if it loses one H, then it gives the lone pair of electron, that bonded pair of electron due to carbon, and H goes as H plus. Now it is a carbon ion. Now here electrophile can attack easily and it forms the final product. So here in place of H, we got the electrophile substituted product. So stereochemistry of SE1 mechanism. Stereochemistry means what will be the exact three-dimensional shape of a molecule. Stereochemistry explains that. So it is decided by the intermediate carbon ion formed. What the carbon ion, the intermediate, which is the carbon ion, that carbon ion decides the stereochemistry of the final product. If the carbon ion may be having a pyramidal shape, if it is sp3 hybridized, or having planar shape if it is sp2 hybridized. sp3 hybridized means 3p and 1s, total 4 bond formation. It can it always having tendency to form 4 bond formation. 4 bond formation means it is a tetrahedral shape. Tetrahedral shape, when it becomes one of the bonded pair becomes a lone pair, one of the bonded pair when there is no bond, whereas the two electrons remain, it gets the pyramidal shape that I am drawing now. See, r1, r2, r3 are connected to carbon. Okay, so this shaded one represents that, the filled one represents that this R2 is facing towards us, and R3 is away from the screen. Okay, it is behind the screen. R2 is in front of the screen, and R1 is on the plane of the screen. And there is a lone pair or two electrons. It is a carbon, you know, negatively charged carbon. So that is part of the hybridization. So for sp3 means 3+1, 4 type bond. So 1, 2, 3, 4. Therefore, it will be pyramidal shape, or it can be even planar shape like this. All R1, R2, R3 are on the plane of this screen only with that carbon. And the two electrons, which is either away from the screen or behind the screen. So two electrons are there in that. Whereas it is sp2 hybridized, so it is planar shape. So this shape, it will decide the geometry of the final product. So carbonium may be having pyramidal shape, or it may be planar shape. Okay, so negative charge was there. So if the carbonium formed is a pyramidal shape and it can hold the shape, that means the intermediate form, the carbonium, and the carbonium gets a pyramidal shape, and the pyramidal shape, it is somewhat stable till the electrophile attacks, so then that can be that is represented here. X plus goes, it becomes a pyramidal shape. Electrophile attacks, and electrophile remains in the same position where initially the hydrogen was there, or initially the X was there, or the leaving group was there. Therefore, the electrophile is retained, or the position is retained. The shape, it is not altered. Therefore, we can say it is a retention of configuration. Configuration is not altered, it retained. Okay, therefore, if carbonium formed is pyramidal and it can hold the shape, then electrophile attack results in retention of configuration. Suppose in certain cases, like R3N with two electrons, R3N 2 dot, that represents a lone pair of electrons, which is similar to that of R3C. So we are having R3C here. When X goes as X plus, it is nothing but R1, R2, R3. Three alkyl group connected to carbon, which is having two electrons, which is therefore it is similar to that of R3 and a tertiary amine with a lone pair of electrons. So tertiary amine molecules, which is having a pyramidal shape, it can change its configuration to invert. It just invert and change the configuration. And both R3N with two electrons and R3C with two electrons, they are isoelectronic. The electronic configuration looks the same, or they have the same, almost same property it would use there, based on the electronic arrangement, the movement of electron, not the physical property as such. Therefore, the such cases, inversion is possible. That means this particular pyramidal shape, it can just invert. So you can see initially the R1, R2, R3 was behind, below the carbon. Now it is above that one. That is just got inverted, just like umbrella got inverted. In the windy season, when you go with umbrella, it may get inverted. You heard about Walden inversion, same type of the inversion takes place. So if it get inverted, then the next electrophile attack, electrophile can attack on the original carbon ion, as well as electrophile can attack the inverted case. So these two shapes are in equilibrium, or they are changing their shape. Therefore, we may get both configuration. So both configuration means the retention of configuration is also possible. Inverted configuration also possible. So both configuration I'm writing here. So the first one, this is the retention of configuration of electrophilic attack. This is the inverted configuration of electrophilic attack. Therefore, we can say that we are getting a racemic mixture. So a mixture of product with retention of configuration and inverted configuration, we call it as a racemic mixture. So a racemic mixture is possible. So if carbon ion formed, the intermediate formed, if it takes the planar shape or planar structure, then electrophile can attack from either side of the giving rise to racemic mixture. Say if the X goes, the leaving group goes as X plus, and we are getting the shape which is planar. We are having the carbon ion, and it is a planar. All the atoms are in the same plane. Therefore, we call it as planar. Then an electrophile, it can attack from the back side. So this arrow which I drawn here, that shows that it attacks behind the screen. Okay, it goes behind the screen. I cannot show that animation here. So you just imagine that the electrophile coming from the back side of that one, or it comes from the top of that. The product formed will be the retention of configuration. Initially, X was there in the same position where E is there. Now we can call it as retention of configuration. If the electrophile attacks from the front side, okay, so this side, our side, the screen side, if it attacks, then there will be an inversion possible. So we'll be getting a product with this configuration. So we can say that if the carbon ion has planar structure, then the electrophile can attack from either side, giving both the retention configuration as well as inverter configuration or a racemic mixture. That means in electrophilic substitution reaction unimolecular, for SE1 reactions, most of the general cases, we are getting the racemic mixture. So racemic mixture is a common product, common nature of the product in SE1 mechanism. So it is not so clear till now that whether it is due to the planar shape of the carbon ion or pyramidal shape, or pyramidal which is getting inverted. Okay, so this is still confusion is going in the science community. But still in SE1 mechanism, both possibilities are explained, and most of the cases we are getting racemic mixture with the SE1 mechanism, most of the general cases. So SE1 reactions are favored if a strong electron withdrawing groups are present on the substrate alkyl group. The starting material, the starting compound, if it contains a strong electron withdrawing group, that is minus inductive effect. What is inductive effect? That I already explained, a video is dedicated for inductive effect. You can see my playlist, the YouTube channel, My Intuition. In that playlist, you can go and check. Okay, go to the YouTube channel, search My Intuition, or you search my name, Dr. Prasad Pudilam. Then you'll get, you can see the YouTube channel. In that, go to the playlist. There is a separate playlist for master degree students. There you can find the electron withdrawing inductive effect. So here an electron withdrawing group, EWD, that is electron withdrawing group, if it is connected to the alkyl group, electron withdrawing group means by the name itself, it is withdraws electron. Therefore that arrow mark indicates that electrons are moving towards that group. So when electron moves towards that group, that means this CH bond become weaker. So those electrons, the H plus can go easily because those electrons, those two electrons are near to the carbon, and H can become H plus very easily. So that is represented here with the schematic. When the H plus try to go, the electron will go near the carbon atom so that H can become H plus easily. Okay, therefore electron withdrawing group supports the or favors SE1 reaction. Presence of polar protic solvents are used for mainly for SE1 reaction. Polar protic solvents, why so? So the intermediate, we know that it's a carbon ion. In case of SE1 mechanism or substitution, electrophilic substitution reaction, the intermediate formed is a carbon ion. A carbon ion molecule as such, it is having a negative charge. So if the solvent is protic, say example, water molecule, we know it is polar. Polar means charge separation, pole separation. Pole means north pole, south pole, you heard about. So that is that pole separation, charge separation, if it is there, such molecule we call it as polar molecule. So H2O, it is a polar molecule. Is a polar solvent. Water is a solvent. H2O is water. Okay, therefore here we can see that partial positive charge for hydrogen, partial negative charge for oxygen, again partial positive charge for hydrogen. And our carbon ion, it is negatively charged. That means if the solvent is polar, the positive charged areas of that polar solvent, it can just stabilize the carbon ion. So it is just an intermediate. Carbon ion is an intermediate formed. It is not so stable. So to form that intermediate, somebody should support it. So these polar solvents will always support the formation of even formation of the carbon ion. Therefore, polar solvents always support SE1 mechanism. Therefore, polar protic solvent. Protic means proton. Proton is H plus. So water, it can give proton easily. So it can extract H plus. So any solvent from which we can take out H plus, we call such a solvent as protic solvent. So here, water molecule H2O is a protic, like alcohol ROH, that is also a protic. Okay, now some of the common reactions or examples for SE1 type reaction. I took 8 examples. First one, that is decarboxylation of aliphatic acid. Second one, that is fragmentation or cleavage or breakage of alkoxides of tertiary alcohol, halogenation of aldehydes and ketones, haloform reaction, which is a special type of halogenation reaction. So it can be categorized under halogenation of aldehydes and ketones only. Fifth one, that is ketoenol tautomerism. Sixth one, that is nitrosation, that is addition of NO plus. Seventh one, that is a famous reaction, HVZ or Helwalla-Hart-Zelinski reaction. Eighth one, that is Torc-enamine reaction. So these reactions, so these are the example for SE1 type, or they follow. Some more, if you look into the mechanism or you study in the depth, we can identify that it follows the same method, SE1 method. First one, that is decarboxylation of aliphatic acid. Aliphatic acids, aliphatic already explained, it is not aromatic in nature. No, benzene rings are not there, or naphthalene rings are not there, benzene type rings are not there, benzene type molecules are not there. Then it is an aliphatic, almost a straight chain molecules. So aliphatic acids with a certain functional group like COOH, COR, RL, AR, NO2, CN, etc. These are the as the functional group which is present in that. Or even it may be double or triple bond, especially at alpha and beta position. Okay, they can undergo decarboxylation reaction which follows SE1 mechanism. So example, I'm showing the carboxylic acid function of carboxylic acid, COO minus, actually COOOH, COOH. The H is taken away, proton is taken away, therefore it becomes O minus. That is CH2, CH2, CH3. Okay, so three carbon atoms further I attach to that. It's just to show alpha, beta, and gamma. So alpha and beta only I'm representing here. So here COO, that is the main functional group. The carbonyl carbon, we call it as a carbonyl carbon. C double bond is a carbonyl group. Okay, so this is the carbonyl carbon, or this is the functional group. Therefore, this carbon is a part of the functional group. Therefore, this first carbon, which is connected to the functional group, we call it as alpha. The second one, we call it as beta, gamma, like that. In some textbook, a different type of alpha, beta name is given. So don't get confused. There you just check which one they consider as alpha, beta. So here I'm considering this particular carbon as alpha and the other second one as beta, then gamma, like that it goes. Okay, so you can even follow the standard. You can check which is the standard one and you can follow that. So I'm not confusing you. Here the functional group is a COO minus or COOH. The next carbon, that is alpha. So at alpha and beta position, if we have a double bond, that means here a double bond or here a triple bond in this particular position in between alpha and beta, if there is a double bond, a triple bond, or if it contains a functional group such as COOH, COR, NO2, CN. Okay, these are all electron withdrawing only. Okay, so that is the specialty of that. Okay, therefore, you can say COOH is attached to the alpha position containing COOH. Therefore, the possible electron movement, okay, the oxygen with a negative charge, it tries to form a double bond with the carbon, then it forms double bond with the carbon. So when it forms a single bond here, that is a second bond here, that means this carbon will become pentavalent. Now already it have four valency, 1, 2, 3, 4. So one more comes here, it becomes penta. Therefore, it will be less stable. It cannot withdraw the 5 valency. Therefore, as soon as this electron shift, the next bonded pair of electron will go to the next carbon atom. Okay, so that is representing with the electrons now. The same thing I am representing with electrons. Those two electrons will move in between that of carbon and oxygen, forming a double bond there. Therefore, here these two electrons are moving towards the carbon, forming the carbanion. Therefore, you are getting a particular carbanion, COOH, CH2 carbanion. And we are getting C double bond or C double bond, which is nothing but our carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide is removed. Removal of carbon dioxide, we call it as decarboxylation. Okay, so decarboxylation already done. Now only we have to think about the stabilization of the carbanion. So decarboxylation already done. Decarboxylation means removal of carbon dioxide. Okay, so this reaction, it proceeds via the involvement of carbanion intermediate. That is already shown here. We got the intermediate. Carbon dioxide is removed, but still intermediate is there. So it has to be converted. So further, it reacts with the solvent molecules, water molecule or the alcohol molecule, whatever medium taken, solvent taken. Solvent is a protic solvent. A polar protic solvent always supports SE1 reaction. Therefore, a polar protic solvent ROH comes. These two electrons will move towards the proton H plus. The OH bond breaks such way that this electron, one of the electron of CH2, I'll show it again once again. Let's say one of the electron of that CH2 minus, one of the electron goes near the hydrogen. It wants to form a bond with the hydrogen. Therefore, the OH bond breaks, the electron will move towards the oxygen, and this will be the nature. Finally, it forms the bond CH2 single bond H means that is nothing but CH3. Okay, therefore CH3COH is one of the product, RO minus, which is the another product. It will further attacked by this molecule, will be further this molecule will be further reacts with H plus present in the molecule, and it becomes stabilized. Therefore, we are getting the final product of decarboxylation. Therefore, same is represented here with Z, that is at alpha position, we are having those groups. It may be COH, it may be COR, it may be NO2, it may be CN, cyanide, NO2 group. Okay, the first step, that is the formation of the carbon ion and removal of carbon dioxide, is a slow process. Then further it combines with the solvent molecule to give the final product, that is a fast step. Therefore, here Z represents COH, COR, NO2, AR, CN, etc. Okay, so here such reaction, loss of carbon dioxide or decarboxylation is the rate determining step or rate limiting step. Rate limiting step and rate determining step both are the same. This rate law, you can say that rate is directly proportional to the ZCH2COO minus. Rate depends upon this molecular concentration. I'm sorry. Okay, so the rate of reaction depends upon concentration of this molecule. So here it is put in square bracket, that should represent that it is concentration. So we are taking the concentration, how much concentration of that molecule is there. So rate directly proportional to that concentration. To make it a equality, we are multiplying with the constant K. So rate is equal to K into concentration of ZCH2COO minus. Second one, that is fragmentation or cleavage or alkoxide of tertiary alcohol, cleavage of alkoxides of tertiary alcohol. Say alkoxide tertiary alcohol with the electron withdrawing substance as COR, allyl, aryl group, NO2 group, CN, it may undergo anionic fragmentation. So representing here, so a carbon with a tetravalency, one of valency with oxygen, H, OH, then R dash, R double dash, and CH2, Z. Okay, so here Z, okay, it is the electron withdrawing substituent. It may be COR, may be allyl group, it may be NO2 group, it may be CN group. Okay, and it cannot be a simple alkyl group. Some simple alkyl group, if it is this type of fragmentation of alkoxide, is not so faster. So it should be electron withdrawing. Alkyl group is electron donating group, that is plus in the T effect. These are all minus in the T effect group. Okay, therefore, there is always electron pull towards this Z. Therefore, this bond. This bond electron movement, it will affect. It will movement will be towards the carbon. Okay, so that will represent here. So here, this is a tertiary alcohol because the carbon, the OH group is attached to a carbon which is connected to three more carbon atom or three more alkyl group. Therefore, we call it as a tertiary alcohol. So it's a tertiary alcohol. The removal of H to H plus, oxygen will get a negative charge. It becomes an alkoxide. Now this alkoxide, in which the electron withdrawing group Z decides the moment because of the presence of Z, which is an electron withdrawing. This O minus, the negative charge, it can combine or it can combine with the carbon as a pi bond, or electron movement takes place towards the carbon to form a double bond there. When it forms a double bond, obviously carbon cannot have five valency. So when form a new bond here, carbon will become five valency. Five valency is not possible for carbon, it is less stable. Therefore, this CH2 bond breaks towards the CH2 because already one electron withdrawing group is there. Therefore, electron movement is always towards that. Therefore, the electron shift towards the carbon, which is connected to the electron withdrawing group. Therefore, we are getting ZCH2 minus and a ketone. So here we know it is a ketone. So alkyl group connected to carbon with the double bond oxygen, again connected to R. So this is a C double bond or a ketone functional group. So a ketone is formed and intermediate is carbon ion. So a C1 mechanism, intermediate is a carbon ion. So the carbon ion further it stabilizes with the solvent present in that polar protic solvent. It becomes ZCH3 plus RO minus. How it is formed, that is shown just a previous example. Third one, that is halogenation of aldehydes and ketones. So it's a very important reaction. A very good example for a substitution electrophilic unimolecular reaction. The R0 base catalyzed halogenation of aldehydes and ketone is a classical example for SC1 mechanism. The example CH3 single bond C, double bond O, single bond CH, H, H. So here a carbonyl functional group is there, and it is connected to two carbon atoms further. Therefore, it is an example for a ketone. Okay, if here any one of the carbon, if it is replaced with the hydrogen, so this entire CH3 group, if it becomes H, it becomes an aldehyde. It becomes the formaldehyde. Okay, the it becomes the acetaldehyde. Okay, therefore here it is a ketone. The ketone molecule in presence of a base, so it is a base catalyzed mechanism I'm showing here. So B represents base. Base is having a lone pair of electron. Base is the one which can take the proton. Okay, so we call a base which is can react with an acid. Acid is nothing but acidicity means it is having protons. It gives a proton. Therefore, a base can take a proton. So CH3C is double bond O. It takes a proton and becomes a BH. When it takes a proton, so as an example, it takes this particular proton, it becomes BH. Then these two electrons of CH bond, it becomes a negative charge. Two electrons will remain with the carbon. It becomes negative charge, or it is a carbon ion. Now this carbon ion further reacts with the halogen. Say example, halogens are chlorine, bromine, iodine, fluorine, they are a halogen. Okay, so here they took the example of bromine, Br2, that is Br, single bond Br, Br2 molecule. So the carbon ion having negative charge, it will attack the negative charge, will try to form bond with the Br now. Okay, so the electron movement is represented here. The electrons, the two electrons in on the carbon atom, it will try, one of the electrons it gives to Br, but Br already having sufficient electrons to get stability. Therefore, this bond has to break. Therefore, the bond breaks and we'll be getting a Br minus ion, so bromide ion as well as Br will be connected to that carbon. So this is the base catalyzed halogenation of aldehydes and ketone. Now under alkaline condition, one position of a ketone is completely halogenated. So here we just represented only one halogen is attached to that carbon. But under alkaline condition, it is very difficult to stop the reaction with a single halogen substitution. It reaction continues till all the hydrogens are getting replaced with the halogen. Okay, so for and the second halogenation, even if it is faster than first halogenation reaction, because already if it gets a halogen atom, we know halogen atom is electron withdrawing group. So that halogen atom will support the removal of that next proton. So okay, so here I can say that so already a halogenation, this is first halogenated one. Already halogen atom is attached here by base catalyzed halogenation reaction. Now this halogen, it is electron withdrawing. So this bromine, it withdraws the electron from the carbon. That means this CH bond becomes weaker. Therefore, another possibility of moving that H plus is easy. Therefore, within the presence of a next base when comes, these two protons can go very easily. So one proton when it goes, it becomes a carbon ion. When it is a carbon ion, it attacks with a bromine molecule. Another bromine atom will be attached here. Then next day again, two bromine atoms. So those two bromine atoms are electron withdrawing. Therefore, this particular hydrogen will become easier to remove. Therefore, it becomes a carbon ion here. And the third bromine atom will attack here. That means once the bromination happened, then the remaining hydrogen of that particular carbon will be replaced immediately by bromine. Difficult to stop the reaction with a mono substitution. Okay, therefore, we'll be getting a tri substituent here since it was a methyl group was there. So, three hydrogen was there. All the three hydrogens are replaced with a bromine. So, we are getting CBr3. So, in unsymmetrical ketone, the preferred site of proton abstraction and halogenation is usually the most substituted carbon atom. The preferred order of halogenation is CHR2, CH2R, CH3 if the protonation takes place to that particular group. Okay, that I can explain here. So unsymmetrical ketone, what is unsymmetrical ketone? So ketone, we know it is the functional group of C double bond O. The C double bond O to that C double bond O, either side, this side it is CH3, right side it is a CR2H. That means it is not symmetrical, unsymmetrical. To the carbonyl carbon, either side of the carbonyl carbon are not having the same atom or group of atom, then we call it as an unsymmetrical ketone. So here it is an unsymmetrical ketone. Now, in the unsymmetric ketone, the preferred site of protonation or proton abstraction, removal of proton or halogenation, it is the one which is having more substituted. So here, this particular carbon is more substituted. It is having two alkyl group. Whereas this carbon, it is less substituted. Anyhow, three hydrogen is there. Substitution means we are telling about. I'm explaining about, what I mean by is the alkyl substitution or electron withdrawing group substitution. Okay, so here it is more substituted one. Therefore, that one is more preferred for halogenation. That means CHR2. So here this is CHR2. So this is CHR2, the first one. This is represented by that one. That will be faster towards, this will give faster reaction towards the halogenation of RDS and ketones followed with the FC1 mechanism. Then the CH2R, then comes the CH3. Okay, so those three examples are given here to understand what is the meaning of this above sentence or statement. Now, haloform reaction, it is a special type of halogenation reaction. Taking the same example for haloform, here one of the substituent on ketone, a secondary alcohol, is CH3 group. Okay, in the presence of excess base and the excess of halogen, a methyl ketone is first to convert into a trihalo substituted ketone. That means we are having excess base and excess halogen if it is taken. Say B plus B with there is a base with a lone pair of electron. This reaction mechanism already just drawn in the previous one example, that is third one, halogenation reaction. Same mechanism I'm showing here. It becomes an anion plus BH. Then further it reacts with the halogens. Here I took the example of iodine as the halogen. Previous one, I took bromine as the example of halogenation. So here to explain haloform reaction, iodine is taken, therefore iodoform, it continues. So we know that the reaction cannot be stopped at a single, with a mono substitution. That is already explained. The halogenation is difficult to stop for mono substitution. It continues, the reaction continues. Again, reaction continues, the third iodine is going to substitute there, and the third iodine is substituted, therefore finally we get the tri-substituted one. So tri-halogen substituted or tri-halo substituted ketone is formed, and it will not stop the reaction there. Further, it continue reacting with OH minus to give product. The OH minus, now it can attack the carbonyl carbon, because here OH minus means a negative charge. This is a carbonyl carbon. Compared to carbon, oxygen is more electronegative. Okay, that electronegativity concept also explained in my previous video. So oxygen is more electronegative than carbon, means between carbon and oxygen, the electrons will be pulled by the oxygen. Okay, therefore oxygen is having more negative charge, carbon is having more positive charge. So carbon is partially positive charge, oxygen is partially negative charge. Therefore, here this carbon compared to other carbon atoms, so this particular carbon which is connected to oxygen by a double bond is more electropositive. Therefore, OH minus can attack that particular carbon. Therefore, this attack takes place when it forms a bond there. When OH tries to form bond with the carbon, that means it becomes pentavalent. Pentavalence is not possible. Therefore, this pi electron will go to oxygen. Okay, so it becomes a COH O minus. Okay, you keep on watching this movement of electrons, and in between you also note it down. The reaction is very important, movement of electrons. Once you understand that movement of electron, then it is very easy to understand the organic chemistry. Otherwise, it is difficult. Okay, it is just like mathematics. Mathematics also you have to learn by writing maximum number of work we do. Okay. Maximum writing work if you do, that is easy to understand, or easy to understand the concept, or we'll get we can recall it easily. Therefore, organic chemistry is also same type. Maximum number of time you have to write it down. Repeatedly watch my video organic chemistry. Each time you watch, you try to write your separate note. You write the note separately on that. Don't forget to, don't stop it anytime. Don't simply watch it. You keep on preparing your class notes along with watching the videos. Okay, so here the O minus, the negative charge is there, that is less stable. It can come back forming the carbonyl functional group C double bond. So when it comes back, the entire C3 can go away, because iodine, all the iodines are electron withdrawing group. So electrons are pulled towards the carbon. That means this C-C bond always there is a strain because electron pulling is there. Now here it's oxygen. It is having negative charge. It wants to get stabilized. Therefore, this electron will try to go back. And always it has got a tendency to go away because there is a lot of electron withdrawing group present in that. Okay, therefore it goes away as CI3 minus. And the other one, it becomes a carboxylic acid. The first molecule it converts into CH3COOH. It's a carboxylic acid. Now here, this is not complete. The reaction not completed. Negative charge is there. It will further react with the proton present in that acid. Okay, we call it as acid because it can donate H plus. Therefore, it takes the proton from the acid and it becomes a corresponding haloform. Here it is iodoform. Okay, CHCl3 is known as chloroform. CHBr3 is known as bromoform. CHI3 is known as iodoform. So that's why the name haloform reaction is a special type of a special case of halogenation of ketones. Example, say complicated, looks complicated, but not complicated one as such. Two rings, hexagonal rings are fused, having an aldehyde functional group, a CH3 functional group is there, and a COCH3 group is there. So we are focusing on that COCH3 group, say carbonyl functional group is there, a CH3 group is there. This hydrogen can be replaced or substituted with iodine. Therefore, iodine, or it can be substituted with halogen. If it is excess base is present, then it will be converted into corresponding carboxylic acid functional group with removal of the iodoform. The fifth one, that is keto-enol tautomerism. Keto-enol tautomerism, the base catalyzed the enolization. Ketoenol tautomerism is there, two types are there, acid catalyzed tautomerism as well as base catalyzed. So here I'm taking the example of the base catalyzed enolization, or base catalyzed tautomerism. Keto form convert into enol form, that particular movement of arrangement we call it as ketoenol tautomerism. Okay, so tautomer, it is taken here as an example. This is the best example for SC1 mechanism. The base catalyzed tautomerism, taking the example of a molecule to express that. Okay, so a particular molecule is taken, which is having a keto form. Okay, so this is a keto form. A carbonyl group is there. Carbon is connected to a carbon, a secondary carbon. Therefore, this is a keto form. So a keto form, in presence of OH minus, it can take a proton. Okay, so OH minus takes a proton because here the because presence of the carbonyl group, there is an electron movement towards this carbon. That means this CH bond, the electrons try to move towards the carbon. Therefore, H can be removed easily. Okay, therefore, it forms a double bond there. It forms a double bond there. The electrons shift towards oxygen. So in a single step, I am showing all the electron movement. Otherwise, I have to draw a next structure with a carbon-carbon double bond. Then it gets an extra negative charge on that carbon. Then the electron moves towards oxygen. Okay, so single step it is shown. So electron proton goes here. These two electrons actually becomes a carbon ion here. Okay, formation of carbon ion, that is the intermediate of SC1 mechanism. So when a proton is removed from here, then it becomes a carbon ion. Then those two electrons try to form bond here, and this electron moves towards oxygen. So in a single step I am showing, already we understood that it follows SC1 mechanism. Okay, so the same structure I'm writing, C double bond C, single bond O minus. Now, it can react further with the solvent, water, say example, H2O. H2O is formed here only, the base attacks the proton, it becomes the solvent H2O. Okay, we know that the solvent H plus will be taken after the a negative charge molecule is present. H plus is taken by that O minus, and the structure I am writing here. Okay, just keep on looking how they like I given the animation to that atoms. Same way, if you write that will be a good method to write the reaction. Okay, so we are getting the corresponding C double bond C single bond OH. So this is the enol form. Okay, so a keto form is converted into the enol, that is alcoholic form. Okay, therefore ketoenol tautomerism, base catalyzed ketoenol tautomerism, that is base catalyzed enolization from ketone form to enol form, that is FE1 mechanism. Nitrosation, compound with active methylene group can be nitrosated with the attacking species like NO plus, that is positive charge to nitrogen. Don't confuse, it is not on oxygen. Positive charges are on nitrogen, or a carrier of it. Carrier means which carries this NO plus, or which can give NO plus. That is a nitrous oxide, for example, HONO can give OH minus and N plus O. Okay, so this is an example of nitrosation. So I'm taking the example, active methylene group. Okay, so methylene group that are represented here. So this is a methylene group, CH2. CH2 is methylene, CH3 is methyl, CH4 is methane. Okay, so methane, if one hydrogen is removed, it becomes methyl group. If two hydrogens are removed, only two hydrogens are there, and carbon having two more valency remaining, that particular group is known as methylene group. So this is a methylene group. Now why it is active methylene group? So it is active methylene group because one of the side is having carbonyl group. So this side attached with a carbonyl group. The other side also attached with the carbonyl group. So from both side, a carbonyl group is connected to this particular methylene group. This carbonyl group, this C double bond, there is always electron movement towards oxygen here. Here also there is always electron movement towards oxygen. That means from this particular central carbon atom, here it is central carbon atom. From this particular central carbon atom, there is always an electron going away from that. That means among this carbon and hydrogen, here carbon hydrogen, here also carbon hydrogen, the carbon hydrogen bond, the electron shift towards the carbon, central carbon. That means CH bond becomes weaker, or H plus, formation of H from H to H plus, it is very easy. That means these two hydrogen are acidic in nature. These two hydrogens can become H plus easily, or we can say they are acidic in nature, or I can say that they are the active methylene group. So this is an active methylene group because of the presence of C double bond, as well as it is further connected to CF3. Two more CF3 attached on either side. Fluorine is again an electron withdrawing group. Therefore, this particular group represented in which the central carbon atom or central methyl group, it is an active methylene group. Now, a compound with active methylene group can be nitrosated with attacking species like N plus NO. So I written NO plus, but still the positive charge is on nitrogen. So this particular molecule, it undergo ketoenol isomerism, that I write first. So a ketoenol isomerization takes place, or tautomerism takes place. So that means here, this particular C double bond, this bond comes, this H becomes, it is an active hydrogen, that means it becomes proton easily, and it will be attracted by the high oxygen present near to that. When it becomes OH, this double bond shifts here. Okay, therefore that electron movement, it is always possible in this particular molecule, this type of molecule. It becomes a ketoenol form, it will be shifting. Okay, so now this double bond can shift back, this H can come back, it gives the keto form. So this is ketoenol tautomerism. Okay, so here, if a nitro so compound, so N plus or NO plus, NO plus means N plus O. Okay, if it comes and attack, then it can attack with the double bond. Double bond means more electron density is there. Here there is more electron density. This will be attached with this positive charge of nitrogen. The possibility I'm representing like this. Okay, so for that first carbon, it loses electron. Okay, so when these two electrons should come near the carbon, these two electron bonded electrons should come near the carbon, and one electron should give to the nitrogen. That means this carbon loses electron. When it loses electron, it becomes positively charged. Therefore, it becomes a positively charged one. Then further removal of a proton takes place, rearrangement takes place, and we'll get a final product, which is a nitroso compound. So the initial product formed, it is a carbon nitroso compound that is stable only when there is no hydrogen that can undergo tautomerism. Okay, so here we got a nitroso compound, but it is not stable. Okay, so the statement says that it is the carbon nitroso compound. Carbon nitroso means carbon connected to nitroso. NO group is connected to carbon. That is only the meaning of CNO nitroso. It is stable only when there is no hydrogen that can undergo tautomerism. There is no hydrogen present. If there is no hydrogen present here, if in place of H, if it is R group, RGA group is there, then this particular molecule is stable. But here it is not stable because a proton is present. H plus H is present here. Therefore, it further undergo tautomerism. H is there. Okay, therefore, further movement of electron takes place. This particular molecule undergo tautomerism to give the product N double bond OH. So this is an oxime. Okay, therefore, nitroso compound undergo tautomerism, ketoenol tautomerism to give the corresponding oxime. Okay, so the reaction is often used to prepare amino acids since the oxymes and nitroso compounds can be reduced to primary amine. So nitroso compounds, it can represent like this. Okay, so that is an example for as a representation of a nitroso compound. In the H plus is represented there, it can be R also. If it is H, then it can undergo tautomerism to give the corresponding oxime. Oxime is C double bond N, single bond O, single bond H. The seventh one, that is HVZ reaction or Hell-Wohlhardt-Zelinsky reaction. Carboxylic acid do not undergo substitution reaction at alpha position under basic condition because a base will remove a proton from COH group rather than form an alpha position. Understood? Okay, so it is always difficult to understand the by reading the statement. That's why I gave the animation here. Okay, I'm representing what I'll shown here. Just as I do the board work, I'm trying to do with the possible animations in my power presentation itself. So this is a particular, this is a carboxylic acid. A carboxylic acid functional group is given here, COOH. So this is a carboxylic functional group and connected to a methylene group, another methylene group, then a methyl group. Okay, therefore, alpha, beta, gamma positions. Okay, so alpha position. Okay, now we have a carboxylic acid and represented the alpha position. Okay, so this is a carboxylic acid and alpha position also I represented it here. Therefore, carboxylic acid at alpha position, they do not undergo substitution reaction at alpha position. Usually, this carboxylic acid will not undergo substitution at this alpha position, that is the meaning, okay. Because of presence of COH group, because H, COOH, this is an acidic proton. Therefore, always whenever OH base, a base catalyst, so we know in SC1 mechanism, a base catalyzed the carboxylic reaction we see in the halogenation reaction, base catalyzed halogenation of aliphatic carboxylic acid. We seen just the previous one. If you don't recall, just go back this video and recheck it. That is the advantages of getting this type of class videos. So you can go back and check what sir said previously, or wherever you get confusion, you can revisit it. So that is the advantages of doing the regular board work. The online the video recorded one is always very important for the student or candidate to understand the concept. I also used to watch many such videos given by the experts to understand the concept. Okay, so here OH minus, a base catalyzed reaction, if you say a base when comes, it has got a proton which is acidic proton already is there, then going for this CH2, a highly acidic proton is there because this OH bond is so weaker, it undergo ionization O minus and H plus easily. Therefore, alpha position it will not attack, the reaction will be taking up to the carboxylic acid functional group only. Alpha position there is no substitution. But this type of substitution is possible. That means the carboxylic acid is treated with Br2 in PBr3. If the reagent used is bromine, bromide, Br2 or iodide or halogen with its phosphorus derivative PBr3, if it is there, then at alpha position also substitution is possible. Alpha position also the hydrogen can be substituted with the halogen. That particular reaction is given by three scientists. Their name combined to become HVZ reaction. Who are those scientists that you go check, identify and put their name in the comment box under this video. Okay, so don't forget to give the names of HVZ, who are Hell, Volhard, and Zelensky. Okay, their complete name you just type in the under the comment box under this video. Okay, so here the example I'm giving: RC, single bond C, double bond O, OH. So a carboxylic functional group is there. Now that hydrogen should be added there to satisfy the valency. So RCH2COOH. Okay, so alpha carbon. So this CH2, this carbon is alpha carbon. So we want to substitute on alpha carbon that you are checking. Okay, so PBr3, the mechanism. So initially the PBr3, it replaces PBr3 because we know that this is more reactive. So PBr3 molecule will replace OH as such. It takes the OH molecule, OH functional group, it takes the phosphorus, takes and gives one Br there. So it becomes a C double bond or single bond Br. Okay, then remaining CH2 is there. Now the acidic hydrogen, the carboxylic acid, acidic hydrogen, it is blocked or covered with Br now. Now it is possible for ketoenol isomerism or ketoenol tautomerism is possible. We seen the ketoenol isomerism already. Whenever there is a double bond, C double bond, and the alpha carbon is having a acidic proton or acidic hydrogen or proton, then this proton H will go to oxygen. This C double bond O becomes C double bond, single bond OH, and the carbon among those two carbon, a double bond is formed and becomes corresponding enol form. So this is the enol form, ketoenol tautomerism. So the ketoenol tautomerism takes place. The enol form I took here. Then further it can be reacted with the halogen Br2, bromine connected to bromine, that is Br2 molecule. Then the electron density, these two electrons, a double bond means here one pi bond is there. Those two electrons, first it goes to carbon, then through carbon it attacks the bromine. Okay, you cannot add bromine in between that of two carbon. Okay, so those two electrons will go to carbon. So this is the moment, the arrow which is shown, the curvature you should follow. These two electrons goes to carbon, then attack the bromine. Then the bromine molecule shifts further. Then H become H plus. It will takes that H will take Br minus. This will be H plus. This will be Br minus. It becomes HBr. When H goes away, these two electrons will go back. Okay, actually, a real mechanism. This here oxygen is having a lone pair of electron, two electron. Those two electron will come here. Then this electron density go to bromine. Then the bromine molecule will shift and give Br minus. That will combine with H plus. Anyhow, this also satisfies the completion of the reaction. This movement of electron, which I shown with the arrowheads. Okay, removal of HBr takes place, and we are getting a product, CBr, Br. Okay. Press it a little bit harder. Okay, so we are getting that Br substitution. So Br substitution has happened at alpha position, but we need alpha substituted carboxylic acid. Now this is not carboxylic acid. Here it is bromine is there. Therefore, further it continues the reaction. Reaction continues, it further reacts with that carboxylic acid. Okay, further it reacts with the carboxylic acid present in the system or in the reagent reaction vessel. Then it further undergo rearrangement, and we are getting the halogen substitution at the alpha position plus the other product, which is one of the intermediate product formed, that also will be formed. Therefore, this is a particular a typical reaction in which there is a alkyl substitution is possible even at the alpha position of a carboxylic acid. So example with a two fused hexagonal ring with CH2COH, Br2, PBr3 in competitive exams. If they give such type of questions, you should not forget to convert it as a CHBrCOOH. The last one, that is stoic enamine reaction. Enamine on alkylation results in a ketone and amine. Final product of ketone and amine. Now what are enamines? So enamine I'm representing. Enamine can be represented in two forms. So this is one of the form of enamine. En means a carbon-carbon double bond. That is represented as en. En means en, double bond, alkene. Amine functional group, we know that is having NH2 or NHR or NR2 or amine functional group. Therefore, this is an enamine. It can further exist as the lone pair of electrons on nitrogen will shift to the NC bond or CN bond for the electron movement represented with the arrowhead. It can also exist as in this form. Okay, it also can exist in this particular form, the plus RX, not that one. This particular, which is there in this circle. Okay, so it can be formed. It can further react with a alkyl halide or alkylation reaction, just like Friedrich-Crafts alkylation reaction, same type of reaction mechanism it is. So you already studied what is Friedrich-Crafts alkylation reaction. Similar type of reaction it is, alkylation takes place. That is alkyl halide, a R3X. Okay, so you already, this is R dash, R double dash, this is R triple dash. Okay, so another alkyl group, that is only the meaning of that. Another alkyl group, or maybe same alkyl group, an alkyl halide, RX group, then this lone pair of electron present here, the lone pair of electron, or the, not lone, here I can say that as a lone pair of electron only, the negative charge or the electron, excess electron, it will be taking a alkyl group, R group, with a removal of a halide. The R will be attached, R is attached to that carbon, but still the nitrogen is having positive charge, therefore it can exist in a isomerism form or the other form with nitrogen having a lone pair of electron than positive charge. That means carbon get positive charge. Now it further undergo hydrolysis. Hydrolysis means we need to add OH functional group. So we have to keep on adding OH functional group, OH here. And here when we add OH also, it becomes further converted into amine only. Here one OH, one more OH will be added, two OH in one carbon. Then from that water molecule will be removed and further it will be converted into ketone form. Okay, therefore we'll be getting a ketone form, R dash C double bond or single bond C R triple dash R double dash H. Plus we are getting the amine. Therefore, we are getting a ketone and amine. So this is the last one, stork enamine reaction. The advantages of this particular reaction is that we can stop the reaction once one alkyl group is added to that. So it will not, the reaction will not continue. It will not repeat. One alkyl group is added, the R triple dash is added there, and the reaction will stop because the product formed is stable. Okay, that is one of the advantages of this. Say example, a particular molecule is given, nitrogen connected to ethyl group, buffyl group, the cyclohexene group. Then it reacts with alkyl halide, so here is methyl chloride. Then further hydrolysis, we'll be getting a ketone as well as the amine. So that's about SE1 mechanism, SE1 reaction mechanism. Hope you understood the concept of SE1 and all the possible examples. Okay, only the general cases are given in exam or in competitive exams. From the given general examples, they will give a particular example itself. But you, if you know the concept of that, then you can write the final product or even the reaction mechanism, or you can write any question asked about SE1. Easily you can answer the questions or even in competitive exam. In coming video class videos, I'll be covering SE2 mechanism, SEI mechanism, then electrophilic substitution accompanied by double bond shift. So do subscribe my YouTube channel, like all my videos so that you can revisit and watch it. It will be there in your YouTube center, that YouTube channel, in your own YouTube channel. It will be there in the playlist. Therefore, easy for you to get it back if you lost the link also. So like the videos and share it to your friends so that they can also understand the concept, because by reading it is very difficult to understand most of the concepts, we may get bored, but seeing the explanation with animated explanation, it is easy to understand the concept. So thank you very much for watching my video. Next class I'll be covering the SE2 as well as the SEI and the double bond shift mechanisms. Once again, thank you and have a nice day.